Welcome to another edition of Medical Device Packaging TV. This program is brought to you by Vanderstel Scientific. Join us today as we explore together important issues surrounding sterile and critical packaging. Once again, thank you for tuning in to Medical Device Packaging TV.
Hi, I'm Jan Gates, and I'm with PackWise Consulting. I'm here today to talk about terminally sterilized medical device packaging for preformed sterile barrier pouches. Now, this is a big mouthful. SBS, or sterile barrier systems, is something that the ISO and the FDA likes to be calling medical device pouches that are holding a product. So when you're talking about a product, too, that is the pouch and the product inside of it. Now, when you get a preformed pouch, you have to put your final closure system on, which is done with a pouch sealer. And today, we're going to talk about individual pouch sealers that's usually used by medical device companies. Now, the FDA has process validation guidance, and in that document, it talks about quality, safety, and effectiveness must be designed into your product. You cannot inspect or test your product to make it good. So, since we're talking about sealing and you cannot continuously measure your sealing to make sure that the strength and that it's continuous is consistent all the time, you work on a validation process. And to do this, you have to control your manufacturing process. You have a lot of things that are going to be happening to your pouch that's been sealed through shipping, shock and vibration, air pressure, that's going to affect that seal. So you've got to make sure it's good. When you're doing pouch sealer validation work, your key considerations are what your user requirements are, what kind of equipment you have with an installation qualification and operation qualification, what kind of material you're using so you know what your sealing parameters might be. Do your process qualification or process operation qualification, often called an OQ, and a process performance qualification where you're tending to make sure that your process is consistent. And then you also have to decide what you need to do for revalidation. Now, with your use requirements, this is something you should document and understand before you actually purchase equipment or try and do your work. You have to know your installation conditions, what kind of safety features you want to have, what kind of production speeds you're going to be using, what kind of spare parts you need for your sealer. You need preventative maintenance expectations, what kind of calibration you need to do. Validate your software to make sure that it's consistent and works well. And then with your preventative maintenance, you need some kind of equipment or auxiliary equipment in order to actually prove that you're running that machine consistently. So, when you know all that, are you ready to install? No. You have to make sure you check your auxiliary equipment and you know what your seal test method is. So, with auxiliary equipment, what I'm talking about is like a pyrometer or some kind of thermocouples that will actually be able to measure temperature. Pressure checks, making sure that all that works properly, your timer, some kind of voltage meter to make sure your electricity coming in is good. Air pressure, if you're using that, some kind of water if it's applicable, you got to make sure that's clean and you actually circulate it well. And then what kind of sealer, or seal testing method, excuse me, that you need to use with that. Now, pyrometers get to be a little bit tricky. Are they fast enough? Can you actually read the temperature properly? Are your units the same as what the equipment says it's going to be? What kind of thermocouple you use on your pyrometer can actually affect how well you can do your temperature measurements. And then you've got to make sure you check your cool down temperature too. There's different kinds of thermocouples to use, and you have to make sure that you're using the right one for your equipment. There's pressure checks. It's amazing how many people forget to make sure that those sealing bars are actually flat, that they're perpendicular to each other and parallel. You've got to make sure if you're using a silicone rubber, you have one here, that it's not too old. Some people will buy 10 years worth of this stuff and the silicone rubber is only good for about a year. What kind of heater bands, any kind of extras you might have, making sure there's no kinks in it and that it works properly for you. what kind of Teflon tape you're going to be using. You've got to make sure it's consistent. You use the right types. There's types that actually have full adhesive on the back. And if you start putting that over your heater band, you could have some issues with burn through, because once you get this adhesive stuff burnt through and taken off, you could be changing your temperature of your heater band. In your seal test method, usually people use ASTM F88. There's different techniques, A, B, and C, which is free tail or some kind of rigid type or something along that line. You have to make sure you're consistent on whichever test method you're using. And you have to validate that you can actually do it properly. Now, you're ready to start. You can check off your user requirements and start your IQ for your equipment. Before we finish this segment, I wanted to make sure that I was clear on the SBS. That is the actual sterilized package system with the product inside of it, and not just the pouch and the product. It has to be sterilized to be called an SBS, but all of this is getting ready for your SBS.
This program is brought to you by Vanderstel Scientific. Discover why organizations like the Department of Defense, NASA, and the Center for Disease Control make Vanderstel Scientific a prime partner. Each episode, Medical Device Packaging TV brings more important insight from industry experts. Once again, thank you for tuning in to Medical Device Packaging TV.
Vanderstel Scientific. Innovations in critical packaging.